Jeremy asks, would anybody in these focus groups care at all about the Bernie Warren story dominating activist Twitter right now? Fuck no. I'm Jon Favreau. I have a new podcast out called The Wilderness. It's about what Democrats can do to beat Trump in 2020, and I'm here to answer some of your questions. Cameron asks, hi, thank you so much for doing another season of The Wilderness. What's one thing you heard from focus group voters that surprised you the most while you were working on this season? So for The Wilderness, I did four different focus groups with four different groups of swing voters. In Arizona, in suburban Phoenix, I talked to people who voted for Mitt Romney in 2012 and then voted for Hillary Clinton in 2016. Because there's this whole segment of voters who used to be Republicans who are now sort of coming over to the Democratic side. In Milwaukee, we spoke to people who voted for Barack Obama in 2012 and then voted for Donald Trump in 2016. These are the sort of infamous Obama-Trump voters. Outside of Philadelphia, I spoke to a group of voters who said they're going to vote in 2020, but they just don't pay that much attention to the news, and they're sort of occasional Democrats. Outside of Miami, I spoke to a group of voters who voted for Barack Obama in 2012 and then decided to stay home in 2016 or vote for a third party. And these voters were predominantly Black and Latino. I think what was most surprising after talking to all these voters is how little they pay attention to all of the shit we talk about every single second of the day. And it's not because they're apathetic. It's because they turn on their televisions or look on their screens and they see politics treated as a game. You know, there was this woman in Philadelphia, in the Philadelphia focus group. She's like a middle-aged Black woman who votes for Democrats once in a while, but she said, you know, I vote for Democrats because I was raised that way and not because I really understand what they stand for and what they're going to do.
I don't understand politics as a whole from my 30 years of being out of high school till now. All my focus was on was raising my son, who's autistic. So I try and look at the different things, but I know I have no understanding. What they need to do is have an understanding class with those who don't understand so they can get a better election going on, because I would love to be in the politics just to see what's going on. But see it now, I want no parts of it. I just turn it off and go something else.
And I thought to myself, like, there are so many people out there who feel this way, and it is on us in the media, in politics, to help people understand the stakes of this election, who might be too busy to really figure it out. My question relates to the party lane debate, moderates versus progressives. Obviously, without endorsing anyone, which lane do you think has the best chance of bringing out the voters that Democrats need to beat Trump? Short answer is, I have no idea. But the long answer is, voters don't necessarily see two lanes in the Democratic primary, one of progressive candidates and one of moderate candidates. We know this because if you ask people who are supporting Joe Biden who their second choice is, most of those people will tell you it's Bernie Sanders. If you ask people who are supporting Bernie Sanders who their second choice is, it's pretty much split between Joe Biden and Elizabeth Warren. So in order for a Democrat to win the White House, you need 270 electoral votes. The first three states that any Democrat would look at are Wisconsin, Michigan, and Pennsylvania. At least Pennsylvania and Michigan are probably the two easiest states for Democrats to win back, though by no means guaranteed. Democrats have a choice between Wisconsin and Arizona as the next state, also potentially North Carolina, Florida could go to. They're in that category as well. So any of those states would probably get Democrats over 270. But the thing is, all of those states have very different electorates, very different kinds of voters in each of those states make up the composition of the electorate. And so different candidates might be stronger in different states. Darcy asks, how does a candidate appeal to both high information and low information voters and still make it authentic? Should we expect this out of one person? What other solutions would work? When we're talking about a message about Donald Trump, I think there is a message about him as someone who is so focused on himself that he's not focused enough on you. And we found in some of our polling with Crooked Media and Chain's research that that was very effective in places like Wisconsin. And when I spoke to voters in Wisconsin, that sort of messaging seemed effective. The same is true in Arizona. The same is true in Florida. The same is true in Pennsylvania. A lot of the complaints about Donald Trump had to do with the fact that all he's doing all day long is tweeting and yelling and getting in fights with people. And meanwhile, all the issues they care about, no one's doing anything about them. So if there's a message that, you know, Donald Trump is tweeting while your healthcare premiums are rising, Donald Trump is getting in a fight with CNN while there was another wildfire somewhere, or while there was another mass shooting somewhere, I think that can be an effective message against Donald Trump. But of course, that's only part of the equation, is talking about what Donald Trump is doing wrong. Democrats also have to talk about not only what we're going to do right and what our plan is, but how we can actually deliver on that plan, how we can get it done. Because one of the things that Stacey Abrams told me, Democrats should be bold and ambitious in our ideas and our plans. But for a lot of the people that she speaks to in Georgia, whether it's poor white folks or poor black folks, when a politician comes and talks and it sounds like dreaming or wishing, and they don't necessarily have a plan of how they're going to get this done, it comes across to a lot of people who don't have a lot, who are working really hard and sometimes struggling to get by, as just that, as just wishing. And they need to hear how you're going to get something done for them and how you're going to tangibly improve their lives before they can actually believe in you and are willing to vote for you. My question is, how do we answer the question of the Trump campaign grouping all Democratic candidates as socialist? I see that as a huge problem in my area, which is heavily Cuban and Venezuelan. Please give Leo belly rubs from me. Rosie Gonzalez-Spears, who works for Andrew Gillum, she spoke about how in 2018, the Republicans really road tested the socialist attack in Florida. They did it with a lot of ads. They did it with a lot of their candidates. And it really did have an effect, because you have a lot of immigrants in Florida. Their view of socialism is the sort of authoritarian government that you see, that we've seen in some Central and South American countries. The best counter to that is to talk about, look, Donald Trump has more in common with the authoritarian socialist leaders that you remember from those countries than anyone else in this country. He's the one that doesn't believe in our fundamental rights and freedoms. You know, a lot of Latinos that she speaks to, what they really believe in is the promise of the American dream, that no matter who you are or where you come from or what you look like, you can come to this country and you can still make it if you work really hard. And Democrats need to identify as that party. Forrest asks, Trump won in 2016 by so few votes in such specific areas. He's slightly less popular now than then. Shouldn't this give me hope, please? Here's the problem. He is slightly less popular in some places. In some places, his approval rating has not really changed since he's become president. But the issue is, the Trump campaign is well-funded, and they are not as stupid as the guy at the top of the ticket. And they are out there right now registering new voters who look like Trump voters, but maybe sat out in 2016. So most of the people I spoke to for the Wilderness said that Trump's turnout in 2020 should be off the charts. The good news on our side is Democratic turnout will probably be off the charts. But an election that's probably going to be the highest turnout election we've seen probably in our lifetimes, when you've got Democratic turnout off the charts and Republican turnout off the charts, that means that we are going to need to persuade some people. We're going to need to persuade some people who voted for Trump to come over on our side. And it's going to be a game of inches. That's the 2020 election. And I don't say that to make you feel, again, optimistic or pessimistic. You should feel neither of those things. Every time you're worried about what might happen in 2020, instead of looking for a poll to make you feel better, pick up the phone, make some calls, knock on some doors, talk to people in your social circle about why the Democratic nominee is better than Donald Trump. Because it is so close, because this election will be so close, it means that you have more power than ever to actually decide the outcome. Thomas asks, in the Wilderness, you address what the Democrats need to do to win, how people have been successful in recent elections, and what kind of issues matter to which voters. But how would you suggest listeners get involved most effectively? Does that change by region or state? So we don't just do podcasts here at Crooked Media. We also have a website called votesaveamerica.com that we launched in 2018 as a one-stop shop for voter registration, volunteering opportunities, ballot information, And we are bringing it back in 2020, and it's going to be bigger and better than ever. And it will have all the information you need on how you can volunteer, where you can volunteer, any other kind of information you'd need to make the biggest difference in 2020. So stay tuned. What made you most optimistic about 2020 while you were recording The Wilderness? I've subscribed, but I honestly haven't started it yet, mainly because I'm afraid it will scare the shit out of me. Megan, don't be scared. Don't be scared. I think what made me most optimistic was a woman named Angela Aldis, who we met in Western Pennsylvania. And she started a group called Voice of Westmoreland. And you know, she has a really, really powerful story, and I'll let you hear it in her words.
The day of the inauguration was really rough.
I, Donald John Trump, do solemnly swear.
And the next days, seeing the Women's March.
Free, choose, love.
I didn't go. I had a newborn at the time.
I can keep quiet.
It was inspiring to see that, but there also, like, immediately I just had this cynicism of, like, what if none of that matters? What if these people aren't going to do any work afterwards to actually make a difference to get him out of office? One day I was driving back home, and I live right near the county courthouse, and it was snowing, and it was right during the height of the Muslim ban. And I saw six people standing out at the corner of the courthouse with signs like supporting immigrants and supporting Muslims. And I pulled over and I started to cry. I couldn't, like, I got teary. I couldn't believe that there was anybody out here who was upset about this and sick about it. And so I ran out, I grabbed my kids and I ran out, and I was like, who are you people? Like, oh my gosh, I can't believe you're here. And I think I blurted out, like, can I buy you all coffee? It's funny, like, millions of people at the Women's March didn't give me any hope, but seeing six people in the middle of Trump land standing out there with signs was like one of the most hopeful things.
And because of that, she got involved, and she decided to start a group in Western Pennsylvania. And it was funny because she said, you know, instead of calling it resistance or you know, anything anti-Trump specifically, because she knew she was in Trump country, they just called it Voice of Westmoreland. And she talked about how she went door to door in her county, where a lot of people voted for Trump. And when someone would answer the door, she wouldn't talk about Donald Trump at first. She wouldn't say she was a Democrat. She wouldn't talk about partisanship. She would just say, what issues are on your mind? She said a lot of people would start talking about healthcare. And she would say, you know, I have MS and I'm terrified that I'm going to lose my health insurance if Republicans stay in office. And she said she was shocked how many people opened up to her, even though they had voted for Trump, and said, I'm worried about my health care too. I don't like the insurance companies. I don't like the prescription drug companies. And she said something to us. She's like, I realized that for so long, we were only talking to ourselves and we weren't talking to the people that we actually need to persuade to vote Democrat next time. It made me so hopeful because there are these groups of people and organizers all over the country who have learned how hard it is, but also how to succeed at actually talking to voters face to face and talking to voters who don't necessarily agree with them. But then they realize that persuasion is possible, that it is actually possible to persuade people who voted for Donald Trump or who didn't vote at all or didn't participate in politics to participate this time, because this election really matters. Thanks everyone for your questions. If you would like to subscribe to The Wilderness, you can do so wherever you get your podcasts, or you can go to thewildernesspodcast.com. And please go register to vote and volunteer at votesaveamerica.com.